Okay, let's use GitHub Copilot to create some functions for us and to modify some functions for us by using comments. These comments are going to serve as prompts, and these prompts are going to instruct Copilot about what we want to do. Let's try to be as clear as possible. In this example, let's ask Copilot to help us create a function to return the Fibonacci number for a given term. This is a classic example when you're learning to code. This is a great way to illustrate how Copilot can help. So let's create a function now, and we can do that by starting with a comment. So let's create our Python comment. Let's say the following: create a function. And what do we want this function to do? Well, look at that. It's already giving a suggestion. This suggestion is to take a list of strings and return the list of strings with the comments removed. So it's actually trying to anticipate our needs even before we started. Obviously, we can ignore this for now because we know what we want to do. We want to create a function that looks at the Fibonacci sequence. So create a function that returns the Fibonacci number for a given term. So that's what we want to achieve. So that's the prompt that I'm providing to Copilot. The next step is to go to the next line by hitting enter, and then we wait to see what happens next. Now it is saying, here's the Fibonacci sequence. That's great. We know this. So what we want though is the function. So we go to the next line, hit enter once more. And now it is starting to show us some code. This is the first part of the code provided by Copilot. So if we want to accept this, we want to accept this definition of the function. We simply hit tab. We go to the end of the line, and now that has turned into actual code. The next step, as you can see, is then produce the actual code body. There is the body for the code that it's suggesting for us. So this is a Fibonacci function for us. If we want to accept this too, we hit tab once more, and we have now accepted this function as produced by Copilot. This is fantastic. The next step is to test this out and to see what it returns for us. Now, it helps to already know some Fibonacci numbers. So if you're doing some manual testing, you want to check that it's actually producing the correct values for you. So let's do this. Let's have a look at the Fibonacci number for 5. And it's even producing a test case for us that is anticipating our needs. So we can press tab and we can hit enter on that and we can print that. Maybe we want a second test though. So why don't we do that as well? Let's create two tests. Let's have a look at Fibonacci for 10. That's a great idea. Now, what is important here is to know what these values should be. What is the Fibonacci number for 5? What is the Fibonacci number for 10? Well, what we are expecting with this test case is it should return a value of 5. And with this test case, it should return 55. So these are the two values we want to see produced by our function here to ensure that it is functioning properly. Let's now save this and let's run this file and see what we get output down at the bottom here. So let's run this file, and what do we get? Two values, 5 and 55. Everything seems to be working properly. That's fantastic. Now we have used this prompt to create a function out of thin air, and it worked exactly the way that we would like it to. Now, what more could we do by using our comments in this scenario? Well, perhaps you've already noticed that it has created this function using the recursion technique, which is a great way to create the Fibonacci function. But what if we wanted to create this function with a different technique rather than using recursion? What if we just wanted to use a for loop or a while loop rather than recursion? How about we ask it to rewrite this function or refactor it without recursion, but by using a for loop? Should we try that out? Let's see what happens if we create a new comment to do that now. Let's go to a new line. Let's create a new comment and let's say the following: refactor this Fibonacci function. Oh, it's suggesting maybe we want to use memoization. That's an interesting technique that we could use as well. Maybe we'll look at that after we ask it to go backward to make it simpler. We could ask it to be more complicated by using memoization. That's a good idea. So let's begin with this. Refactor this function to use a for loop instead of recursion. Okay, so we go to the next line. We wait for it to interpret our prompt and do something for us. Sometimes I find that it doesn't respond right away at the next line, so I'm going to one more line down, and there you go, it's now responded with a definition of a new function. It's named the same, that's fine for now. We could in fact comment this out afterwards to ensure there are no issues or clashing. Let's hit tab to accept this. We want it to create the function without using recursion, but by using a for loop. And as you can see, we have a new code body here. And you can see this is a lot longer, and in fact, it is much less elegant than the recursive approach. But I think it's important to show that you can ask for refactoring and ask for a different approach to be taken to generate a function. So let's hit tab to accept this. We now have a new version of the Fibonacci function. Perhaps it's more simpler, perhaps it's complicated. Depends if you are comfortable with the idea of recursion or not. All the same, we can see that we have this. So now what we want to do, we want to test this function out. We're going to rerun these two test cases and see if we get the same output. So let's do that now. But before we get to that stage, let's go back up here. Let's just comment all of this out to ensure there's no clashing. So I'm going to comment all of that out. I'm going to come down here and I'm going to simply say print Fibonacci 5, and it's recognizing that's what I want to do, because that's what I did before. Being intelligent is anticipating what I'm going to do. And 10, and you can see it's recreated these test cases, including the comments I added here about the expected values. So you can see it is interpreting and intimating what we want based on the context of what we have done so far. So let's now save this and then rerun this and see what we get in the dialog box below. So I'm going to save this and then run, and let's see what we get. And we get a 5 and 55. As you would expect, everything is working beautifully because, of course, this function is correct. Great. Now, one of the suggestions that we had up here was to use memoization. This is a really good technique. It's a way of caching previous results to speed up things when we want to look at a Fibonacci number for a very large number. Now, if you've ever worked with a Fibonacci number, you'll have realized that as the number gets larger and larger, when you're using a recursive function or even this for loop, it can take a very long time to return the values if it's calculating them afresh each time. But by using memoization, we can cache the results, and we can use that cache to make it simpler to generate our return results. So let's do that now. We're going to ask it to use memoization. So let's come down here and let's say the following. Refactor this function, or rather this Fibonacci function. Let's try to be as specific as possible in case it gets confused. Refactor this Fibonacci function to use recursion and memoization. It's anticipating what we want. We then go to the next line, wait to see if there's anything. Nothing in this one, so let's go down one more line. And as we can see, we now have a new function definition suggested for us. So let's accept this by hitting tab. We then get the code body suggested to us. And here you can see we now have this code body and we are using memoization. Okay, so let's hit tab. We've now accepted this and we have a new version of the Fibonacci function using recursion once more, also using memoization. Okay, so let's now comment out our version over here, use a for loop just to ensure there's no clashing. And now what I want to do this in a test case, but I'm going to do a couple of things. I'm going to start with our smaller numbers. Then I'm going to create a really big number and see how quickly it can generate that result for us. And what we could do is we could go backwards and see just how long it takes to do it for the same large number by using our non-memoized version, just to show you how much faster that approach is. So let's go down to the next line and let's create that. And look at that. Already it knows we want to test because we've done this before. So I'm going to accept that test case. See if it comes up with the second one as well. Does it recognize you on that one? No, that's okay. Let's start typing. It will recognize, I think, pretty fast. Yep, there we go. 5 and 10, which is what we've done up until now. So let's save this and let's rerun this and see if we get 5 and 55 output the window below. So here we go. We're running the code. And then we go 5 and 55. Everything seems to be in order. Now, the next thing is to try this with a really large number, just to show how fast it is when using memoization. So let's create a new test case. And for this test case, let's look at, and it's even recognizing that we want to do it for 50, and it is suggesting to us what this will be. This will have a return number, which is very large, 12586269025. Okay, let's accept this and see just how quickly it generates this value for us at the window below. So save and rerun, and let's see what we get. Very quickly indeed, there's the value we expected, and we are getting that value. Now, let's comment out this memoized version, and then let's do the same case here, but with this slower version, just to see how much slower that is without using memoization. Okay, I'm going to comment that out, come back up here, uncomment all of this, and I'm going to create my test case. And it is saying, you want to look at 50 again, don't you? And you can see how it is being intelligent and anticipating what we want to do based on the context of the code we've already written, based on the prompts we've already asked and provided. So you can see how Copilot is being a true pair programmer. It is experiencing this coding experience with you, and it is coming up with suggestions and ideas based on what you've done so far and what it thinks you might want to do next, which is one of the great things about using Copilot in your day-to-day coding. Anyway, let's save this. Let's rerun this function. And you would have noticed it was returned in a flash. Let's see if it takes a little longer when using this more complicated, or rather this simpler version. It looks more complicated because there's more going on in this code. It's just less elegant than our recursive version. But let's run this now and see what we get. So I'm going to hit run and see how long it takes. So you can see we're running. And whilst it was also very fast, you should have noticed this came out slightly slower than when doing it with this version down here. How about we now try an even bigger number? See if this gets stuck. So let's come up with the following, 100. Okay, And let's remove this comment because that's not correct. And let's say the following and see if, and there you go, it is creating the number for us. That is a massive number. Let's see if it can even handle this, okay? So I'm going to save this, I'm going to rerun this, and let's see if it gets stuck. If it does, we'll just stop it out and we'll start again, and then we'll look at the memoized version. Okay, so this is saved. Let's run this now. Hit run, and it did it. It took a second. It was a little bit slower. Again, it's not very perceivable because I've got quite a powerful computer, but what we could do is go up even further and see if we can do it with an even bigger number. So how about we do that? Let's have a look. The following, Fibonacci, and let's come up with a number. What number should we use? How about we use 1,000? Oh my goodness, look at the size of that. Okay, let's accept this. You can see that is more digits than I want to read out. That's a very big number. Now, if we run this, let's see what happens. And if it does again get stuck, we will pause this and try it with the memoized version. So, okay, then let's run this and see what happens. Here we go. Hit run. And it did print it out, but you can see there was a slight pause. It took a little longer to generate it for this. So let's now take a look at the memoized version to get an idea for just whether that is faster than this version over here. So I'm going to comment all of this out. Let's come down here. Let's just comment all of that out for the time being. Let's come back down to our memorized version. And then let's look at Fibonacci for, we actually want to look at 1,000. Focusing on, if you remember. 1,000, and the return value is absolutely massive. There we go. So let's save this and run this and see if that happens a lot faster than using the for loop approach. Okay, so here we go. Hit that. And I think you can see that was slightly faster. Now, what I'm trying to show you here is that Copilot is helping us to create different versions of our function by offering different techniques. And in this case, we're looking at a classic example of Fibonacci. We are looking at memoization versus standard iteration versus standard recursion. And I'm trying to show you that as the number gets larger in Fibonacci, using iteration is much slower than using memoization. Maybe what we could do is ask Copilot to help us prove this. And to do that, what we would like to do is maybe use something like the timeit library. And then we could use this module to actually time the different functions to see whether or not they are slower or faster than one another. This is something that you could do in your own time, in fact. So maybe you could use Copilot with this example, ask it to use the timeit module and see if you can actually quantify how much faster using memoization and recursion is than using an iterative approach for Fibonacci. This is a great project to use Copilot to build upon your own experience of interacting with it by using the comments as prompts and then seeing if you can prove to yourself whether or not one approach is better than the other. Great. Now, rather than spending any more time looking at the Fibonacci function, how about we do one more example? And in this example, how about we create a class? And with that, we're going to see if Copilot can help us create some of the methods for that class, and also whether or not we can look at some of its suggestions and then reject those and look at better suggestions for how to do things. Let's create a really simple class. And I'm going to create this to begin with myself. I don't need Copilot to do this for me. I'm going to create a class called Person. And then within this, I'm going to go to the next line. And I'm going to create a comment. And I'm going to say what? It's saying, do I want attributes? I'm going to say, I want a constructor. So I want a constructor. It recognizes I want a constructor, hence the autocomplete. We go to the next line. And then what's going to happen? It should create a constructor method for us. And there we go. It has taken a guess at what we think we want for this person in terms of attributes. And it's started off with a name and an age. And those are reasonable attributes to assign to a person object. Let's accept that by hitting tab. And we have now created the beginning of a class. Next up, how about we create our own attribute? Let's call this job. And let's assign this an initial value of none. I'm not asking for anyone to provide this during the construction phase. We're simply initiating it to none within the init dunder method. Now let's create a method within here. And let's call this add job. And then as you can see, Copilot is trying to be helpful. It is offering some autocomplete suggestions for what we could do with this method. Just accept those for now. Now what I want to do is actually refactor this method. So I want to consider whether or not they already have a job. And if they do, I don't want them to add a job. I want to return a message that says we already have a job. Let's create a comment, which is going to be our prompt. And we're going to say the following. Refactor this to check if the person already has a job and return a message if they do. Okay, so that's a fairly explicit prompt. Let's see what happens if I go to the next line. So it's now waiting to do something. It's thinking about it. Nothing's happening yet. So let's go to the next line again. Oh, I was too slow. So there we go. If self.job is equal to none, that is one suggestion. But maybe we could ignore that suggestion and go to the next line and see if it's got a better suggestion. Ah, so what's happened here is I've been too quick. So let's create ourselves a comment telling Copilot what we want to do. So I'm going to say the following. Refactor this method. Check the person already has a job and print a message if they do. So that is my comment. That's what I'm asking you to do. I'm trying to be as detailed as possible. So we go to the next line. Let's see if you can interpret this requirement and then create some code suggestions for us based upon this requirement. So on the next line, we'll wait a moment to see what happens. Ah, so here we have a suggestion. If we have a job, so you can see we're doing a conditional check. If self.job, this would return true if this is not none. Print a formatted string literal, which is an F string to print out the name of the person already has a job and the job itself. This is a very detailed suggestion. I like this. Alternatively, if we don't have a job, assign job that's provided there to the attribute job, then print it out is now so-and-so. Great, this all looks good. I'd actually accept this, but just for the purpose of this video, let's reject this suggestion and see what it offers in terms of an alternative suggestion. If I go to the next line, instead of hitting tab, I'm going to hit enter. Let's see what happens next. This is a more simple approach, if self.job is equal to none. So I'm going to hit tab to say, yep, that sounds fine to me, or then go to the next line. And what's it going to say? Well, if it's none, assign this, okay? And then we'll have an else clause, because of course, if it's not none, they already have a job. Here's the else clause. Then there should be a print statement. Great. There we go. I said I wanted to print a message if they do, and it is giving us a print message if they do have a job. Excellent. Then I go to the next line. And as you can see, this is currently all in comments, but if I want to accept this code, pretty easy for me to just go over here and uncomment it. Okay. There we go. We have now added some more code and refactored this method by providing a prompt within the method to Copilot. And as you can see, the initial suggestion is actually probably more elegant, professional than what we have here. But it was a good idea to show how you can reject suggestions if you don't think it looks like what you want to do and see what the second or third alternatives might be from Copilot. Now, of course, there are so many more things that you could do with Copilot in terms of using comments to provide suggestions or descriptions of the things you're trying to achieve in your code. You could be refactoring, you could be testing. There are all manner of different things that you want to do. And we'll look at some more of these in another video. But in this video, all I wanted to show you that was by using comments that you can provide suggestions and descriptions to Copilot, ask it to help you to produce things in code. I've used the Python language in this instance. You could, of course, use another language. But what we also were able to do is we were able to create functions, test those, then ask for refactoring or additions or modification to be made based upon other suggestions that we had. And we also looked at how we could look at a suggestion when we were looking at the object-oriented class. And we could reject a suggestion and look at the next suggestion, then accept that instead. As I've said, there's so much more that you can do with this. This is just the tip of the iceberg. But the main premise is that by using comments and by being descriptive, you can interact with Copilot and it can help you to do things very specifically. Equally, if you're not being very explicit, you might get suggestions that come back that don't meet your requirements. So it's important to think about the way that you do your prompt engineering, the way that you create your prompts. The same as if you're interacting with something like ChatGPT. The more detailed and the more precise you are, the more likely you are to get a response that you would expect. And Copilot works in much the same way. It's the same reason that it was able to come up with this initiation method here. It knew that we were looking at a person class, and it was able to think, okay, I know what a person is. I understand the concept of a person. Let me suggest some attributes for a person. Those were name and age, and those were reasonable attributes for it to suggest when I asked for a constructor. Of course, it didn't add a job. I added this myself. It doesn't know that a person has to have a job or not. This is very particular to my requirements for this class. But again, if I'd have put in here constructor with a list of attributes, it would have done that for me. So you can see, depending on how detailed you are or aren't, you're going to get different results. So my advice is to experiment, play around with this, and to see how by using these comments as prompts, you can get Copilot to work with you. Of course, whenever you're just writing code out anyway, you're going to get autocomplete, which we've already seen. But the purpose of this video is to show how we can use comments to interact with Copilot by using them as prompts. Hope you've enjoyed this, and I'll see you in the next video.